Ladies and gentlemen, if I may have your attention, dear family, friends, colleagues of Marta Roggenkamp, A warm welcome on behalf of the Faculty of Law to this, what we refer to as the hour of power. I feel the air filled with energy and law in anticipation of a hopefully electrifying farewell lecture of Marta Hoogenkamp. We are here together in this beautiful aula today to celebrate the accomplishments of Marta Hoogenkamp as she retires from her position as professor of energy law at our university. My name is Kars de Graaf, and I will be the chair today. I will keep it short, but just to mention the respect we have for Marta's work, I wanted to mention that for the past 15 years, Marta Hoogenkamp was the highly appreciated and very well-known center of knowledge concerning energy law, not just within her very own Groningen Center of Energy Law and Sustainability, but also within our law faculty, within our university, and in Europe and in the world. She was basically, and still remains, a rare energetic force of energy law, a force that appeared to many of us as seemingly inexhaustible. As her retirement came nearer, she opted to plan a farewell lecture and invited all of us, close colleagues, family, friends, and energy law enthusiasts, to witness her farewell lecture. Her farewell lecture of about 30 minutes, 31, I understand, titled Energy Law in Times of Transition, Quo Vadis, will no doubt be fascinating and insightful. Therefore, I would like to ask her now, without further ado, to come forward and give her farewell lecture. Marta, you have the floor.
Okay, dear family from the Netherlands and Norway, friends from several parts of the globe, alumni also from several parts of the globe, and colleagues, I think mainly actually from the Netherlands, as our colleague from Aberdeen was unable to travel to Groningen due to Brexit. His passport was older than 10 years, and apparently he is not allowed to travel into Europe. No problems traveling to Qatar, but not into Europe. So he is unfortunately not here. But anyway, I thank you very much for coming to Groningen for my farewell lecture, and I appreciate for those who have traveled a long way that you have done so. I know that my, well, I say almost a disability is that I can speak too quickly. So if I do so, please raise a hand and I will try to slow down, but then maybe it is more than 31 minutes. So this lecture is also an opportunity to look back and to try to look forward. And I have to say that is not easy in a time of an energy crisis. When looking back, I have the advantage of almost 40 years of experience, and I hope also of expertise on developments in the energy sector and energy law. And energy lawyers know that it is not an easy subject to grasp, and that it takes time to understand the intricacies of energy law, and I can tell you it's going to be more and more complicated per year. In 2006, I presented my inaugural lecture in this aula, but then I was up there. As I was appointed as the first professor of energy law in the Netherlands, I thought it at the time appropriate to focus in that inaugural lecture on the very basic question, what is energy law? Given the increasing interest in energy law, the question is still relevant, I think. Energy law is, for example, more than mergers and acquisitions in the energy sector, as some law firm rankings often used to indicate. It is also more than environmental and climate law, albeit both affect the energy sector. In my opinion, energy law is in essence the legal framework governing the entire energy chain: production, transport, supply, and consumption of energy. These individual parts of the chain can of course be studied in isolation, but one always has to take into account the entire energy chain. One also needs to realize that there are several energy chains. Oil, gas, electricity, and heat each have its own energy chain. So each of them can, of course, be studied in separately, but there is a close relationship between these energy chains. Gas is a primary source for electricity production, and electricity production may again result in heat supply. One of the buzzwords at the moment is system integration. And it is interesting to see the advocates of system integration focus on the conversion of electricity to gas, and not the other way around, the role of gas in electricity production, as currently is still a day-to-day business. One other special feature of energy law is its network-bound character. And as such, it differs greatly from other economic sectors. In other words, one needs to take into account the role and the organization of these networks, even if you're in your research or your work only deal with production or consumption of energy. The next question is obviously how to organize this energy chain. And in principle, governments and legislators have a choice. After World War II, governments generally opted for a system of vertical integration, which means that a few companies, government or privately owned, had the exclusive right to carry out one or more parts of the energy chain. This changed in the 1980s and 90s due to the introduction of market liberalization. In the EU, but also in other parts of the world, please do not forget, also market liberalization in the US, Canada, South America, New Zealand, etc. However, the situation in the EU differs to some extent from the other parts of the world, as the aim is not only market liberalization, but also market integration. And that is the need to create one internal European energy market, rather than have many individual national energy markets. And the recent discussions in the EU on gas pricing demonstrates again that this process of market integration is still ongoing. Please also note that the trend towards market liberalization is not limited to the energy sector, but applies to all economic sectors, and maybe can be seen as a signal of consumer or citizen emancipation, power to the people, curse. In the EU, market liberalization principles are directly based on the EU treaty principles of free movement of goods, services, capital, etc., without distortion of competition. However, this freedom is not unrestricted. The EU legislator did and does recognize that energy is an essential good and thus may require special treatment. As energy supply is in the general economic interest, it can be protected via public service obligation. The extent to which member states have made use of this possibility differs, but the Netherlands have been hesitant to do so, I think. In addition, many politicians in the Netherlands voiced that market liberalization equals less rules. This presupposition is actually wrong, completely wrong. In a liberalized market, we need rules, maybe even more rules, as these rules provide the framework within which market participants can operate. So market liberalization is not equivalent to having less rules, and it is neither the same as privatization, as often claimed by many journalists, and which I think is highly irritating. Privatization is about private parties taking over shares in government-owned companies, but it is not same as liberalization. In short, energy law involves a legal framework governing the energy chain, the energy change, and market liberalization is currently one of the key elements of energy law. Obviously, climate law and environmental law have a major impact on the energy sector. For example, as it requires the reduction of greenhouse gas emission, as clearly demonstrated in the Urgenda case, and also attempts to streamline environmental permits with the development of energy projects, as we see in the newspapers quite regular, for example, gas production in the Waddenzee, or now also the need to expand the electricity grid and how that can take such a long time due to all kind of permitting. Apart from this, also other areas of law influence the energy sector. This is property law, who owns the energy sources, and increasingly consumer law. And this brings me to another important feature of energy law, and that is supply security. Supply security involves the availability of energy sources as well as the availability of supply routes, and is now at the focus of attention since the Ukraine war and the energy crisis following from that. Supply security is also the challenge to provide consumers with a regular and affordable energy supply. And supply security is often also discussed in case of a crisis, as was demonstrated in the 1970s when the world faced an oil crisis. Currently, we are in a gas crisis, And this has a particular impact on the Netherlands, as Dutch final consumers have since the 1960s relied on the supply of natural gas from primarily the Groningen field. The estimated closure of the Groningen field in 2023 puts the Netherlands in a completely different situation than before. Instead of relying on Groningen gas and supporting other member states by supplying them with our gas, the Netherlands is now one of the others and need to rely on suppliers from outside the European, except for Russia, of course. This serious reduction in domestic gas production is clearly a matter of supply security. And it is thus interesting to follow the parliamentary inquiry that tries to unravel the background and arrangements made with regard to gas production in Groningen. It seems that some have questioned the argument that gas production in Groningen was necessary for supply security. Personally, I find this rather surprising, as the current gas crisis proves that Dutch production potentially could be very relevant for securing energy supply. Another matter is, of course, whether the responsible parties some 10 or 15 years ago considered the income derived from gas production more relevant than actually safety of the people living in the province of Groningen. This inquiry also shows the lack of transparency of the legal regime governing gas production in Groningen. This is in itself not surprising, as the legal framework is based on the French law of Mr. Napoleon and several private law agreements. Looking back, it is a shame that the legislator, when drafting the 2003 Mining Act, did not bring the old concessions in line with the new mining regime. I do realize that this would not have been an easy task, but lessons could have been learned from other countries like Italy and Denmark, where old concessions have been adapted to modern times. So currently, as a result of the above, the Netherlands has to learn to deal with this new situation. Instead of being a gas-producing and exporting country, it has become a gas-importing country. We have to rely increasingly on imports of LNG. So far, little attention has been paid on the legal framework governing LNG. And I believe this certainly deserves some more attention. Given the reduced levels of gas production and increased gas imports, the next question is whether concerns about supply security are a stimulus for energy transition. And if so, does the law provide sufficient provisions to do so? Energy transition entails the process of phasing out fossil fuels and replacing it with renewable energy sources. In the Netherlands, the prime renewable energy sources are solar and wind, to some extent also, of course, geothermal, as we obviously lack serious hydropower potential. Nuclear energy is regaining attention, but the status of nuclear energy is still a matter of debate. It is, I need to say, not a renewable energy source, but it does not emit CO2 either. The discussion with regard to the taxonomy regulation shows that renewable and green energy sources are not necessarily the same. Moreover, the production of nuclear energy is based on a different legal regime, primarily influenced by international law. In the Netherlands, there is little expertise on nuclear energy law. And with nuclear on the rise, it will be relevant for academic institutions to also study these developments in the near future. Leaving aside nuclear, we have to rely on solar and wind. Given the geographical position of the Netherlands, wind energy seems to be the most likely option, and is therefore surprising that the Netherlands ranks so high in the EU statistics on solar energy. By contrast to wind energy, the share of solar is mainly the result of private initiatives and consumers installing solar panels on their rooftops. Currently, we see more and more large solar panels being developed, just like in the past, the large wind parks. These large solar and wind parks are to be considered as a major producer, a major generator similar to conventional generators. The main difference is the possibility that the public can have a share in these projects. Such citizen participation is a tool to increase public acceptance and limit public opposition. Past experience have shown that developers have to be careful when designing a project based on citizens' participation. The most successful examples are those where citizens jointly develop and generate clean electricity and sell the electricity on the market. And of course, getting financial benefits themselves. So these private investors in these renewable energy projects and small consumers installing solar panels on their property are currently in a favorable position given the high market prices for energy. But I want to stress that these developments are the result of market liberalization. Prior to market liberalization, consumers were not in a position to generate electricity themselves, as this was the exclusive right of licensed producers. The opinion voiced by some politicians that the current energy crisis illustrates the failure of energy market liberalization is therefore surprising. Of course, energy liberalization is an ongoing process and may require that the legal framework needs to be adapted on a regular basis. But we should also consider its benefits. One of these advantages is that private parties can install these solar panels and be an active market party. So instead of relying on these old, exclusively licensed producers and suppliers. Indeed, promises made in the past by some politicians that energy liberalization would result in lower prices were false and misleading. The fundamental idea was to provide consumers with the freedom of choice, and potentially market forces could have resulted in lower prices. However, market liberalization has no or less influence on the availability of energy sources, as the current energy crisis clearly demonstrates. So the next question that would be, is the way out of the current energy crisis more citizen participation? Maybe, but I think only to some extent. Would citizen participation be a tool in promoting onshore gas production? I would argue that this is too late, given the distrust of gas production onshore overall, and it will be difficult to change existing legal arrangement, amend licenses, and of course also onshore gas production is declining. For onshore solar and wind, it may help. In this case, the question is how such citizen participation should be designed and how the citizens will benefit. From an energy law perspective, it is interesting that the EU presented in 2019 a new concept of consumer participation, energy communities. And this concept goes beyond the current facilitative instruments like net metering and the fiscal advantages. Energy communities have to meet specific requirements, such as the prerequisite of being a legal entity, and depending on the energy source itself, the requirements that the participants in the community are situated relative close to the energy source. The most interesting element of these energy communities, I think, is the possibility that by law the community is entitled to supply energy to its participant in the community. Normally, only licensed suppliers are entitled to supply small household consumers, and it can thus be questioned what the consequences are of the fact that these communities do not have to meet the same financial and technical requirements as licensed suppliers. It is neither clear what happens in case of bankruptcy of an energy community. So can the participants then in the energy community rely on the same legal protection as ordinary customers, or are they in a danger of not being supplied? Well, the latter is probably not the case, as long as they are connected to the public grid and not have been physically disconnected from the grid. However, it remains unclear whether the mechanism of appointing a supplier of last resort will apply automatically or in a similar manner to these energy communities. And there was another question that came to my mind a couple of days ago, and which I actually want to raise with you, is the extent to which these energy communities can be used as an instrument to assist low-income consumers living in rented accommodation owned by large housing associations. These tenants are not able to install solar panels or energy efficiency measures themselves. So could these low-income consumers benefit from housing associations to become an energy community? This question has to be addressed. It has to be addressing this question whether these housing associations meet the basic requirements of the EU directives. So it has to be a legal entity, and who are the parties of the community. Apart from this, they also have to offer their tenants the possibility to choose another supplier if they so wish. However, turning households of housing associations into energy communities may solve another requirement of the EU directives, and that is that energy communities need to provide economic and social benefits. And I think probably this arrangement could lead to additional social and economic benefits. I therefore would be in favor of investigating this route, as it may be one of the few possibilities for tenants to achieve lower energy prices without having to install solar panels, etc. themselves. It does, however, require some incentives for the housing associations to promote that they will become an energy community. The discussion about energy communities have again led to a debate on energy networks. As mentioned earlier, energy networks are a crucial part of the energy chain and, of course, of energy law. Without a proper network, energy supplies come to a halt. Key networks are, of course, pipelines and cables, and as energy supply depends on their availability, they are considered as essential infrastructure. The European Commission acknowledged a long time ago, already in 2008, that it is necessary to establish which infrastructure is to be considered as critical infrastructure, and then to also establish specific measures to protect that critical infrastructure. Given the principle of subsidiarity, member states had considerable freedom in deciding which infrastructure should be considered as such critical infrastructure. But we see in practice that primarily the networks of the transmission system operators are considered as critical infrastructure. Obviously, these transmission system operators are already required to invest and maintain the grids, and thus in that regard also to guarantee supply security. But pursuant to the Critical Infrastructure Directive, network protection is also requiring additional measures like monitoring and emergency mechanisms and the need for more regional cooperation, as a failure of one network, of a network in one member state can of course affect supply in another member state. One of the key elements of governing critical infrastructure is the so-called N-1 rule. This entails that a member state needs to ensure that in case of a failure of a cable or a pipeline, another supply route is available. The transmission system in the Netherlands is meeting this requirement, but it is not necessarily the case in all EU countries. But what about offshore? What about offshore pipeline system? The recent damages to the Nord Stream pipeline system in the Baltic Sea make me question whether this system of transit pipeline actually was designated as critical infrastructure. And in general, whether offshore energy systems are subject to the regime governing critical energy systems, such as monitoring and emergency measures. Again, this could be an interesting topic for further research. The policy on critical infrastructure does focus on transmission systems and less on distribution systems. The latter systems are crucial as most final customers are connected to the distribution grid. However, their position in the energy chain is changing. Instead of merely being a service hatch in between the TSO and the final customers, the distribution system is getting several additional roles. It needs to connect an increasing number of local producers of renewable energy, and resulting from that, it is confronted with congestion and congestion management measures. In addition, I think there is a trend also towards developing more alternative local networks. EU directives governing the earlier mentioned energy communities include the possibility for these communities to develop their own networks. The Dutch legislator does not seem to support this, despite earlier attempts to experiment with alternative grid solutions and prior to that, private lines. In spite of major hesitations of the Dutch government towards the development of alternative grids, I would argue that this development cannot be stopped. New network concepts will emerge anyway, as the market is changing. Moreover, given the serious investment needed to develop networks following the growth of electrification, private investments could be very beneficial. Last but not least, these private or alternative grids can be considered as a sign of the earlier mentioned consumer emancipation. Instead of fighting this development, the focus should be on examining the different scenarios and develop legal frameworks facilitating such grid. The key elements have to center about assessing the parties who want to invest, checking that investments are made accordingly, ensuring that the operations of the new grid operators and the DSOs are aligned, and last but not least, guaranteeing proper regulatory oversight and control. The presumption that networks should be government-owned needs another debate, as the current rule was introduced some 20 years ago as part of a discussion on ownership and bundling, and was based on the idea that the national regulatory authority lacked sufficient experience. And then I wonder, is this still a good argument? In other words, is the time now ripe for other networks? And maybe also interesting, can lessons be learned from other privately owned networks, such as the upstream offshore gas pipelines? This brings me automatically to the last topic I would like to discuss, and that is, in short, energy at sea. Coastal states have been producing and transporting energy offshore since the 1960s. However, this was limited to oil and gas on the continental shelf of the North Sea. So far, production and piped transportation is basically national in scope, except for some cross-border fields and transport of gas from the Norwegian continental shelf to the UK and Europe. The situation is now rapidly changing as the same coastal states are aiming at large-scale electricity production offshore. So far, the electricity produced is mainly by offshore wind parks, but soon will we see other types of installations and sources, such as floating solar panels, but possibly also small floating nuclear facilities. Electricity is, of course, transported via cables to shore and are constructed and operated by either the national transmission system operators, like in the Netherlands, Germany, and Denmark, or a privately owned transmission system operator, as in the UK. The approach chosen so far has been successful, but it can be questioned whether it is sufficient to facilitate future offshore energy developments, especially when taking into account that the Dutch government recently has announced that some 75% of electricity production will have to come from the North Sea. This requires important changes to and potentially a complete overhaul of the current legal framework. When taking the Netherlands as an example, the legal regime applying to offshore energy developments is primarily the Mining Act, governing the production and transport of oil and gas, the Wind Energy at Sea Act, governing the production of electricity offshore by wind, and some provisions in the Electricity Act, governing transport of electricity to shore, and the possibility to financially support renewable sources offshore. The draft Energy Act that will replace the current Electricity and Gas Act is not really, and that's surprising, not really addressing developments offshore. And this is striking given the share of energy that will have to be produced offshore. So what needs to be done? First, one needs to have a close look at the rules governing production. How do we regulate new types of offshore electricity production? One option is to change and broaden the Wind Energy at Sea Act to a Renewable Energy at Sea Act, so that at least also the production of electricity via floating solar panels is covered. However, another trend is offshore energy conversion, so hydrogen production, within a turbine or at a wind park or maybe on an isolation. Should this also be governed by the Renewable Energy at Sea Act, or do we need another legal framework? Currently, the law does not facilitate this development. Moreover, what should the legal framework be for renewable energy production on or close to an existing oil and gas installation offshore? If the electricity is used exclusively for gas production, the situation is straightforward, as it will be subject to the Mining Act. But what if certain volumes will be transported to shore or supplied elsewhere? It's not governed by the Mining Act. So the law does not provide. All North Sea states are now examining whether electricity produced offshore may also be consumed offshore. Currently, the law does not contain any provisions regulating offshore electricity consumers. So, as an example, when connecting a producer offshore with a consumer offshore, in principle, the cable between those can be considered a direct line. But this does depend on the phrasing in the national law, and also whether that part of national law applies outside the territorial waters. And even within the territorial waters, there is still a problem if the offshore consumer needs a connection to shore, as under Dutch law, a connection involves a link between an immovable property and the grid. And offshore, we have no, or at least not yet, immovable properties, as Jaap knows very well. About another interesting development, I can't actually avoid mention it, offshore artificial islands. Denmark is the first North Sea state developing such an island. It's interesting to see the step-by-step approach that they have used. Following a political agreement on the need of such an island, they drafted a law governing the development, the construction development of the island. This law enables the tendering of an artificial island next summer, the summer of 2023. However, there is not yet a legal framework in place governing the use of the island. We know that the island will facilitate an offshore energy hub and thus acting as a connection point for electricity cables. We know that wind turbines may be constructed on the island and that there will be facilities in place for hydrogen conversion. We also know that the island will be developed by those commercial parties that win the tender together with the Danish state via its state participant. However, it is not yet clear whether these commercial parties, together with the Danish state, as the economic owners of the island, also are exclusively entitled to operate the island, or whether others also can use the island, and if so, under which conditions. So I would expect that probably there will be a new law emerging also have to regulate these issues. This brief overview shows that the North Sea will become an important energy source. This process requires not only a proper balancing of all activities, but also a facilitative legal framework. This legal framework needs to solve the above legal issues and regulate production, conversion, transportation, and supply, but as recent developments have shown, also safety and security. All coastal states are entitled to safeguard the activities onshore, on their onshore and offshore territories, and also take the necessary measures to safeguard themselves from activities resulting, for example, from transit cables and pipelines. So far, such transit pipelines have often been developed on the basis of bilateral agreements. For example, the NordPipe, EuroPipe, ZeePipe, but also the Bechtel-Balsand pipelines are based on a bilateral agreement. These agreements usually include a provision stating who is responsible of ensuring pipeline safety and also actually carrying out pipeline safeties. By contrast to these pipelines, the Nord Stream pipeline system is not based on a treaty, and it's thus less clear who is responsible for guaranteeing the safety of those pipelines. I started this lecture with again asking the question, what is energy law? I hope this presentation has shown the breadth and complexity of energy law. I also strongly believe that experts in energy law should be aware of all aspects of energy law given their interdependency. Personally, I started my career with acquiring knowledge of oil and gas law and gradually expanded my expertise to downstream electricity and gas law, energy transition law, and climate law. When someone would have told me a year ago to focus again on gas law and study the regulation of gas storages in the Netherlands, I would not have believed it. But I think it illustrates the point I just made. In other words, although specialized knowledge on a particular area of the energy sector is very valuable, and many academics are specialists in a particular area, I would strongly urge them and other energy law specialists to go beyond their particular scope of expertise and try to understand and acquire basic knowledge of all aspects of energy law and thus the entire energy chain, and also actually all energy chains. The title of my presentation is Energy Law in Times of Transition, Quo Vadis. I think the above has shown that the energy sector is in transition and that this will affect the law. I believe that energy law is also in a phase of transition, and that there are challenges ahead that go beyond, for example, the current draft Energy Act in the Netherlands. Given the need to develop offshore energy projects, it can be doubted whether this act is sufficient and whether we need to discuss some sort of integration of the laws governing both upstream and downstream energy activities. To conclude, a few reflections on the position of energy law at the University of Groningen. Prior to getting my chair in 2005, I had several lengthy interviews. Apparently, that's normal. During one of these interviews, someone asked me the question what I aimed at achieving. My answer was that my aim was to have established a center of expertise on energy law that would continue to be viable after my retirement. I think I've been able to fulfill the goal I've set myself. Since my appointment, research has focused on many of the issues I discussed above, but also on issues like carbon capture and storage and the Energy Charter Treaty. And I'm very happy to see so many researchers and former researchers in this room, as well as many graduate and postgraduate students. Teaching has expanded from one course on energy law to a master on energy and climate law, soon a double degree with the George Washington University, an executive master on energy law with the University of Aberdeen, Groningen, Aberdeen, Copenhagen, and Oslo, and also a postgraduate program in Dutch on energy law for practitioners. All three programs have proven to be successful and assisted in Groningen becoming a center for hardcore energy law, research, and teaching. Recent developments and the current energy crisis show the relevance of energy law and the need for expertise on energy law. The result of my hard work since 2005, I leave behind as a gift to the faculty and the university, and I sincerely hope that this legacy is treasured so that energy law in Groningen can maintain the position it currently has. Thank you very much.
Well, Marta, that's what they call going out with a bang. I'm sure you generated new interest in the field of energy law and are excited about doing as much research as you have done until now. And some of them may even be re-energized in their current topics of PhD research or otherwise research at our faculty. Thank you so much. Maybe when she planned her farewell lecture, she thought this would be it, a farewell lecture, then a drink and a bite. But of course, we had different ideas about that, and we felt that we had to celebrate her accomplishments by allowing some colleagues and dear friends to talk about the impacts that Marta has had on the energy sector and the world at large. And to start with one, I'm allowed to read an email that we received this week from the Academic Advisory Group of the International Bar Association. Dear Marta, the Academic Advisory Group of the Section of Energy, Environment, Natural Resources and Infrastructure Law of the International Bar Association wants to join you in this farewell lecture to thank you for your intense and productive work within the group, your long-lasting service to the aims of the group and that of the section, and the energy you have deployed to keep the group working hand-to-hand with Council. We hope to continue to benefit from your expertise and work and wish you a very happy and prolific new period in your scientific and personal life. With our fondest wishes, Inigo Del Guayo, who is currently in Ecuador and wanted to be here, but the world is not that small. So impact on the world, but also, of course, impact on the world of energy law. And to reflect on your impact on the world of energy law, we invited Lee Henscher to share a few words on your accomplishments. Lee, you have the floor.
Thank you very much indeed for the invite, and thank you, Marta, for a really, invigorating lecture this afternoon. I don't think anyone who knows Marta would expect that Marta would go out with anything other than a bang. Certainly not, as the poet said, with a whimper. That's not the way something, such an important chapter in your life ends. You've talked a lot today about the future and the really, I think, challenging agenda for energy lawyers in the coming months, years. I'd like to dwell a little bit on the past, of course, but I'd like to pick up some of the themes that you have presented today that are so important for energy law. Because I'd like to say, well, they're also important for energy lawyers, their connections, their networks, their communities, and maybe there's a bit of offshore as well in the themes that I want to touch on. I've been given 5 minutes, and I know that we are under strict, very strict orders to keep to the 5 minutes, so I don't think I can do justice in these 5 minutes to all your achievements in the field of energy law. Over the past, I think, almost 40 years. I know we lawyers aren't very good at maths, but I know that I met you back in 1986. We both joined the Institute of International Energy Law, set up by Professor Slot there, which was at that time part of the University of Leiden. And you came as already an expert in Dutch mining law, Dutch oil and gas law. And I think you published the first monograph in the area, certainly in English. And not only were you an established expert at that early age, so long ago, but you also had a network. And you brought a huge network of connections with you, which I was always astonished at how many people you knew in the industry. And not only did you know people in the industry in the Netherlands, and I have to say there weren't many academics at that time, but you also had, of course, a fabulous network in Norway. And you drew on that network to set up a seminar in the London Norway seminar. I'm not sure what we called it then, but I always called it the Nordvag seminar because that was where we had it. And we had it in a very nice hotel, Amsterdam, and it was always great fun, because there was always quite a bit of alcohol added to the sort of serious side of things, so much so that I remember standing behind a Norwegian colleague who was checking out at the end of the seminar, and he was asked very politely by the receptionist, "Sir, did you have anything to drink from the minibar?" And the guy looked horrified, and he said, "Anything to drink? I emptied it." And so this was really very much the standard of those seminars. They were very serious, but they were also, as I say, great fun. And it was a great networking opportunity, I think, for many people. So I think many people owe you a great debt, and indeed some of them are in the room today, who I think were some of the earliest participants in those seminars and survived the minibars. So, in fact, you've not only sort of launched that seminar series, but you've kept it very much alive over the years. And looking at Intercentia, the publisher's website, you're now publishing and editing volume number 14, based on the contributions at that seminar, which you have wisely moved out of Noordwijk to a more, I think, serious place where it is now held, so there are no minibar temptations. So we've heard also about your connections with the IBA, the International Bar Association, and its academic advisory group. We just had a message from our colleague Inigo Delgado, and I think that was also an experience we shared joining that group in our early years at Leiden. And indeed, I was going to echo the very sentiments that Inigo Delgado expressed in his email. You've been an extremely active and loyal member of that group, another network, a very international network. And you have edited, you've contributed to many volumes that have been produced by that group on a huge variety of issues and subjects in energy law. You've edited two of them on energy networks, which is obviously a subject dear to your heart, as we heard today, but also on energy and technology. But you've contributed, of course, to many more. And you've published way more than these series that I've just mentioned. And you set up, of course, the journal, the Dutch Journal of Energy Law, the Dutch Association of Energy Law, too many to mention in my allotted 5 minutes. But I think that it's important to really stress from the publications that I have mentioned that it's your loyalty and your determination that have created these networks and really also communities of energy lawyers who've really benefited from your very tough editing skills. We're all terrified of you, of course. And so you're one of the few people I know who can make people actually deliver. When you edit a volume based on chapters from people who are working very hard in all sorts of sectors and who have any number of excuses for being late, you were never very convinced. So you were a very tough editor to work for, as I'm sure many people in this room and listening online can testify. So what I think has also been so typical is not only your sense of community and how important networks have been for you throughout your career, but I think, and there's again, I think many people will share my views here, that you have a boundless interest in energy law, and that, of course, resonated this afternoon in your speech. There's so much to be done, and your energy and your enthusiasm has never, ever dimmed, and I doubt that it will dim in the coming years. So, in fact, you referred to the committee that appointed you back in 2004, I think. I was a member of that committee, and I think I was the one who suggested that you might set out your objectives and your aims for the future, because in my heart I already knew that you would come up with a good plan and a plan to set up a flourishing institute. And it's not often in your life that you can say, I was proved right, but I think that I can say that looking back, because I really insisted that would be your lasting legacy, if you like, to this university. And indeed, you have a flourishing centre of energy law, and now energy law and sustainability. You have a very big North Sea energy law programme, colleagues participating from four different countries, from the UK, from Denmark, from Norway, as well as the Netherlands. And so you did deliver on that expectation, that professional expectation of the committee that appointed you at that time. And through those programs, of course, you have promoted very many young scholars. I've also been privileged to be in the promotion committees for some of them at least, and to read their excellent theses. So it's been an amazing legacy. And as many of your colleagues will say, we hear it a lot of you, never a dull moment. And that, I think, is really, I think, a very fitting phrase to describe how you have approached energy law, your colleagues, created these networks, created all these energy communities. And thanks to you, indeed, we've never had a dull moment.
Thank you, Lee. Well, of course, people in the room who don't know you are wondering who's she to know, but Lee Henscher, ladies and gentlemen, is the professor of energy markets in Bergen, Norway, and of course also the professor of European law at Tilburg University, and part-time in Florence, so she should know. And she does. Thank you so much. We now turn to closer to home, our university, and specifically our faculty. Our dean, Wilbert Kolkman, is here to shed his light on the accomplishments of Marta within our faculty. Wilbert.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Dear Marta, esteemed guests, behind me you see a fairly large tree, if you look closely behind the PowerPoint. Imagine this tree being energy law in Groningen. The tree was planted some 15 odd years ago by Marta Rochenkamp, and she almost single-handedly raised it to its formidable proportions of today. Now, the tree has one trunk, but as you can tell, it has numerous branches going in two directions: research and education. Marta has put Groningen on the map in both of these fields. Let me just briefly illustrate this. Let me start off by research. You can pick a side. Marta has laid the foundations for and participated in national and international research consortia. For instance, under Horizon 2020, she co-founded the Groningen Center of Energy Law. I'm just giving a few examples, as painting the entire fresco would take way too long. An extensive number of PhD students was supervised by her, several of whom are not depicted here, but are here today. More than once, she was the ladder. I think you can tell where that one is for her staff's career. Education. In education, the tree has countless branches as well. Marta established the LLM in energy law, the first in the Netherlands. Alumni praise this program. In great numbers, they are here, but also they have found employment with well-known energy companies, law firms, in the public sector. Marta has put her heart and soul into teaching. Most strikingly, also the international collaborations, one of which is the North Sea Energy Law Program, an advanced LLM, as already mentioned. But of course, the real question is, one may wonder, what is the secret behind all this? How can one person accomplish all of this? I've been thinking and thinking, and I think there are three ingredients. One of which is hiding in plain sight. It's, of course, energy. For several decades, Marta Rochenkamp worked day and night, maybe only not in the early mornings. This is a joke. On her projects, research, teaching, she's put boundless energy into energy law. She devoted herself tirelessly to the subject in the broadest possible sense. But energy alone fades if it is not focused. And to be able to add focus, one needs vision. And I think that is the second ingredient. Marta has shown a keen ability to identify certain new developments at an early stage, also recognizing their legal trials and tribulations beforehand. So new development, new technologies, new questions. Before anyone even considered the legal implications, Marta was already on top of things. But energy and vision go nowhere without proper steering. All of these achievements, I think, would not have been possible without Marta's resolute leadership. So that, I think, is the third ingredient. The tree had to grow in a certain direction, and it did. Dear Marta, the University of Groningen and the Faculty of Law are greatly indebted to you. In the recent past, the UG already showed its gratitude, for instance, by an eminent royal decoration, and by placing your portrait in the Senate Hall, just down the hall, the academic heart of this institution. You are the only law professor alive to be granted that honor in Groningen. And today I can only underscore this. So thank you, Martha, for what you have built in Groningen, or what you had grown in Groningen. The university wishes you well, the faculty wishes you well, and not in the least place, the energy law section wishes you well, whom now will be given the floor. Thank you.
This is exactly what you want, a dean that makes your job easier. Thank you so much for your words, but now it's indeed time to hear from the section of energy law, and here represented by Ruven Vleeming, upcoming established scholar in energy law.
Well, thank you very much for a nice introduction. Of course, compared to Martha, always one that is still upcoming, so you're absolutely right about that. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm standing here indeed on behalf of the section of energy law, but also on behalf of the Groningen Center of Energy Law and Sustainability. Now, we grew from very humble beginnings some 15, 16 years ago, and now indeed, this is much, much bigger organization. So we are collaborating with institutions from all over the world, actually, from different continents. We have different programs. We just discussed that already. So there is a lot of activity going on. And I think what is clear to everybody, and that has been made clear by the speeches as well, is that would have not been possible at all without the relentless drive of Martha, one, for scholarly perfection, but also, two, for getting things done. And that really is a key aspect of what she has been doing and what probably she will do until the very last moment that you will breathe on this earth. I'm absolutely sure about that. Now, that means, you know, we have now sort of come to a critical age, right? 15, 16 years. That is, all of you in the room who have kids know, that's a time when it's getting very complicated. Huh? But also, from the other perspective, that is sort of a time where it is still a bit early to let go, right? It is, if you really see your kids moving out with 15, 16, that is a tricky one. That is a very tricky one. Now, what we want to make sure to have this legacy of energy law being continued is we thought about a number of things that we could do for you, but I think crucially it is really making much more sense in this particular discipline. So what we have come up with is a plan, and the plan is here. So I need to ask you to step here next to my side, and while you are unwrapping this already, you need to unwrap it now. No, it does not break. I can tell you something about it, ladies and gentlemen. That is sort of a collaboration. We have put together an editorial team. So Lee was in it, Kars was in it, Edwin was in it, and my humble self was in it. Thank you very much. And of course, what we wanted to do is we wanted to bring together the creme de la creme of energy law to write a book for you that we aptly called A Force of Energy, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow, wow, wow.
This is the book. We have 36 authors from all over the world, literally, in this book. And to really reach out, because that is what you wanted to do, to reach out with energy law, this is not only a book, this is actually an open access publication that is available for everybody from this moment onwards. But I know that you are not that fond of these kind of things. So anybody who sort of shares that sentiment could also go downstairs sort of after my speech and, of course, the closing words of Kars. There will be an inspection copy of this on display in the Spiegelsaal. So, Martha, Thank you very much for what you've done for this section, for the entire Center of Energy Law, and indeed for energy law as an academic discipline. Wishing you all the best for the future.
Well, she seems happy with it. But, we are almost at the end. We had planned this until 6, so we're running a little bit late, but let me just ask whether Marta feels that she wants to say a few words after these speeches, and then I'm sure we're pretty much ready to get to the drinks. Marta? Okay.
Thank you very much. Not sure where to start. But maybe first of all, thank you all for coming, because it would have been very sad if only one person would have been sitting here in the hall. So, and I was getting a little bit worried with all the cancellations I received this afternoon for all kind of different reasons, but I'm very, very happy to see all of you. Also, thank you very much for those others speaking today. Very much appreciated all those kind words. They are a blessing to my soul. And of course, I would like to thank very much the organizing committee. And that is Kars, Ruven, Edwin, I know have spent a lot of time in preparing this. And although I was completely out of the picture here, I didn't even know where to be this afternoon, only I had to be at the academic building at 4 o'clock. So I really, really appreciate all these efforts you have put into this. And of course, this very beautiful book. So, and it is not a tiny book. It's a big, big, big book. And of course, I don't have to edit it. How nice. So, I really, really appreciate this. And, well, this is my farewell, but I warn you. It's not a farewell of energy law, as Lee already pointed out. It's my farewell of Groningen. I have joined my 15 years here. I have spent far more time on it, mean days, nights, etc. And as said, not early in the morning, never. But of course, we still have the Dutch Energy Law Association, where I can put a lot of time and effort in. And there are probably other opportunities that will arise as well. So I really hope to see all of you soon, or maybe less soon, in some sort of a meeting, seminar, whatever, on energy law. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you actually also for this. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, now we come to the end of this farewell lecture. I wanted to just briefly restate that you've seen from Lee Henscher, who is the editor of the book, and Ruven Fleming, you've seen me, but actually there's one person that has been really enthusiastically organizing this book and also this day, and that is Edwin Woerdman, and he should deserve an applause for himself, actually. Then I would all like to invite you all to move downstairs, get something to drink, hopefully something to eat. If you want to enjoy the Senatskamer and maybe take a look at the portrait of Marta, we will make sure that you will be able to. And as a last request from Marta herself is that you will not form a line in front of her trying to celebrate her. Try to get something to drink first. Take a look when she's free, and she will walk around. Please enjoy yourself, and then everything will come to you. Thank you so much for being here, and enjoy yourself, and Marta. Okay.
Yeah.